Ostene nobis Domine misericordiam tua.
Et sanctitate tua in mano nobis.
Domine exaudi orazione mea.
Et clamavi sanctitate
mea. Dominus vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu
tuo. Oremus. Exaudi nos Domine sancta pater omnipotens et eterne Deus. Et emite redignere sanctorum angelorum tuum de celis, qui custodiat, foveat, protegat, visitet, atque defecat, omnes habitentes in hoc habitaculo, per custum dominum nostrum.
Dominus vobiscum.
Oremus, concede quesumus omnipotens Deus, ut qui ex merito nostre actiones et legimur, tue gratiae consolatione respiciermus, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Sinae nimon sest in arabi. sequat Jesus, veceras sicum dicema. Qui hic est vere propheta veturus, emodi mundum, Jesus ergo cognoscibi se, quia venturi esset ut rapperet eum, et facerunt eum regnum, ulti interrumpit mortum ipse solium.
Of announcements, we continued the novena this day, as we started in this week in preparation for the Feast of the Annunciation. So immediately after the Mass, we would follow that with the Decade of the Rosary and the prayer for the Priory Court project and for the St. Mary's Academy. We also send our congrats to Father Jolly, who today, 25 years ago, was ordained deacon. So it's very fitting that he is deacon for our Mass today, so we wish him all the best for that. Be remiss as well for me not to mention today's Mother's Day, so we wish all the mothers a very blessed Mother's Day. And immediately after this Mass, if you come forward for the mothers, if they come forward like you would at communion time to come to the altar, you will receive a rose. So please come for that in honour of your dignity within the world and within the Church. Translation of St. Paul's Epistle to the Galatians. Brethren, you will find it written there that Abraham had two sons. One had a slave for his mother, and one had a free woman. The child of the slave was born in the course of nature, the free woman's, by the power of God's promise. All that is an allegory. The two women stand for the two dispensations. Agar stands for the old dispensation, which brings up its children to bondage, the dispensation which comes to us from Mount Sinai. Mount Sinai in Arabia has the same meaning as the allegory as Jerusalem, the Jerusalem which exists here and now, an enslaved city whose children are slaves. Whereas our mother is the heavenly Jerusalem, a city of freedom, so it is that we read, "Rejoice, thou barren woman that has never borne child. Break out into song and cry aloud, thou hast never known travail. The deserted one has more children than she whose husband is with her. It is we, brethren, that are children of the promise, as Isaac was. Now, as then, the son who was born in the course of nature persecutes the son whose birth is a spiritual birth. But what does our passage in Scripture say? Rid thyself of the slave of her son. It cannot be that the son of a slave should divide the inheritance with the son of a free woman. You see then, brethren, that we are sons of the free woman, not of the slave. Such is the freedom Christ has won for us." Continuation of the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, Jesus retired across the Sea of Galilee, and there was a great multitude before following him. They had seen the miracles he had performed over the sick. So Jesus went up onto the hillside and there sat down with his disciples. It was nearly the time of the Jews' great feast, the Paschal feast. And now, lifting up his eyes, seeing that a great multitude had gathered round him, Jesus said to Philip, "Whence are we to buy bread for these folk to eat?" In saying this, he was putting them to the test. He himself knew well that what he meant to do. Philip answered him, 200 silver pieces would not buy enough bread for them, even to give each a little." One of his disciples, it was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what is that among so many?" Then Jesus said, "Make the men sit down." There was no lack of grass where they were, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. And Jesus took the loaves and gave thanks and distributed them to the company, and a share of the fish too, as much as they had mind for it. Then when they had all had enough, he told his disciples, "Gather up the broken pieces that are left over, so that nothing may be wasted." And when they had gathered them up, they filled 12 baskets with the broken pieces left over by those who had eaten. When they saw the miracle Jesus had done, these men began to say, "Beyond doubt, this is the prophet who was to come into the world." Knowing then that they meant to come and carry him off so as to make him a king, Jesus once again withdrew onto the hillside all alone. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. As a reminder, of liturgical colors for this day are that of rose for the fourth Sunday of Lent, Laetare Sunday. It is because we are at the halfway point of our Lenten journey. So a great question for each one of us on this fourth Sunday of Lent is, where are you at in your Lenten journey? Are you able to look back with honesty at yourself since Ash Wednesday and say that you are more charitable, more patient, more loving, more generous, more prayerful, more disciplined? Are you more fully alive in the faith? If you are, thank the Lord. If you are not, the great thing is that we have another half of Lent to go. We can start today. The beautiful thing about this Lenten season is the Lord and the Church gives us every single year the opportunity to start again and to begin again, to begin anew. Because God desires your conversion. God desires my conversion. He desires the conversion of the whole world if we make ourselves available to him. It is possible. So where are you on this fourth Sunday? What needs to change and be recommitted in your life today? Your Lent can start again today if you've lost motivation. We are in the middle of Lent, but we are in the middle in more ways than one. We are in the middle of Lent, but we are also in the middle of our difficult road to God. Who among us wishes to become a saint? Who among us wishes to go to heaven? If we do want to be a saint and go to heaven, the difference between someone who does and someone who does not is someone who becomes transformed by the power of God. Someone who elevates themselves above their human nature. If you want to go to heaven, if you want to become a saint, we must rise above our basic nature and become supernatural above human nature. We all know the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000 very well. Story which maybe we've learned since our childhood, and probably we could recount it by heart. But let us pay particular attention to the attitude and the actions and the words of the apostles in our gospel today. When Jesus desires to feed the multitude who have followed him out into the countryside, the apostles hesitate. St. Philip speaks about the exorbitant costs of feeding 5,000. Andrew talks about the littleness of the resources they have, the few loaves and fish. The apostles are focusing on the negative, but they're also focusing on the worldly. and their little ability on what they can bring. And then in this, they are neglecting the power of our blessed Lord, a Son of God. Even though it has been demonstrated to them time and time again, the power and the healing which Jesus has performed before them. The apostles sadly miss the point. Their full conversion has yet to take place. And we still need to pray for that. With regards to the successors of the apostles in particular, they need our prayers enormously. Look what's happening now in our universal church these days. Look at Germany. Germany is literally dying. The bishops' conference in Germany is publicly going into schism. They had been warned by the Vatican, but now they have gone full throttle in their evil, evil plot. And there's no other word for it. They are telling the people of Germany who are in a same-sex or marriage, a sodomite relationship, that they should call upon their priest and ask him to bless their union. That's demonic. And the bishops of Germany are doing this now. And yet the Vatican remains completely silent. What is their thinking? Their thinking is clear for anybody of faith. Their thinking is of the worldly, the woke culture in which we live in now, wanting to conform themselves to appease the woke culture rather than holding true to the teachings of our blessed Lord. There is great danger in this. We know this even from Scripture. The first pope was called Satan by our Lord. In Matthew chapter 16, when Jesus is foretelling his passion, Jesus clearly tells Peter and calls him Satan. Why? Because Peter is thinking not as God does, but as human beings do. Peter has conformed himself to the world still, and he is thinking as men do. He was thinking in terms of the social pressures of the world, telling basically to our Lord, pain is terrible, suffering is terrible, sickness is terrible, this will never happen to you, Lord. And Jesus clearly says to him, get behind me, Satan. If we conform to the world, we will change no one, and we will not be following our blessed Lord. Theologians and scripture scholars talk about the three conversions of St. Peter. First, when our Lord calls him on the sea and the seashores of Galilee. Secondly, after when our Lord looks upon St. Peter after he denied him three times. And the third conversion was at his Pentecost. We need to pray for the conversion of the world, but also this extends to the church, those some people in the church. More than anyone, the apostles who followed Christ realized what he could do. How different is their attitude to those who were lame, blind, and possessed, but approached our blessed Lord. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus continuously commends them for their great faith. They come with nothing, some of them not even able to walk, whereby their friends have to carry them in to meet the Lord. But they come trusting in our blessed Lord and in his divine power. In spite of the obstacles and difficulties, they trust in Jesus, that he knows that they can bring healing. By means of the miracle of the 5,000, Jesus teaches his disciples to trust him. Whatever they meet with difficulties and in their apostolic endeavors, they are called to trust fully our Lord. This was the important lesson to the apostles, who would face so much opposition and seemingly in the impossible task of taking the faith to the ends of the earth. An important lesson to them, but it remains a lesson for each one of us to learn again and again the importance of the spiritual life and its dependence on our Lord. As the angel Gabriel said to Our Lady at the Annunciation, nothing is impossible to God. Which attitude then do we take in our spiritual lives as we move forward? Do we take that of the apostles who doubted in the gospel today? Or do we full-hearted trust in our Lord, despite all the faults and failings which we may be surrounded by at this time? Or that of the apostles who worry and fret and doubt and forget the power of the Lord? So often we find we need to take the time to step back from the world that we live in, from all the politics that's going on, and to re-put our focus on our Lord. Conversion means turning to, and we must turn to the Lord. In order to become a saint, to become holy, in order to spread the gospel of our Lord, it requires a great cost. And this is what we must be able to endure. So often we stop and consider the cost, like St. Philip did. He says, but it costs this much, a huge sum. And therefore we give up and never begin the necessary work to follow Christ. Other times we look at the resources that we have. We look at our time, our money, our intelligence, our small little virtues, and consider them, that none of them are sufficient for the task of the Lord he's asking of us. And so we give up or never begin. What the Lord asks, we say is too much sometimes. And like the elsewhere in the Gospels of the rich young man, we go away sad. Yet our blessed Lord demonstrates to us today in the miraculous feeding of the 5,000, with such small resources, he demonstrates to us the greatness of his power. Truly nothing is impossible to the Lord. In our weakness, he demonstrates his power. We need not fret or worry. He asks us to bring to him what little we have, to make the offering of our limited talents, and by his grace, he will provide to them all that is necessary. We must have faith, turn to him, and not be dispirited. What is the point of our faith? Most people will say that Jesus died on the cross so that I could go to heaven. This is a very shallow take on Christ's will. Christ became flesh and lived among us and died so that he could recreate himself in us, so that we could live through, that he could live through us. He died so that we could have union with him. This is the Christian life. These are the three steps that we do, that no everybody must undertake, whether in this life or in purgatory. The ways, the purgative way, the illuminative way, and ultimately the unitive way, union with Christ. And this can be achieved right here, right now. And that we may experience, as St. Paul says, no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. God has put on your heart a conscience, a law which he has laid upon you, that if you follow him, if you do his will, he will be with you. The world works from the outside in. Christ works from the inside out. We are called to be transformed. From the outside, the world will pressurize us, it will push on us, and it will repress us. But allow Christ, in the midst of the craziness that's going on in our world and sometimes within our church, to transform you. Open yourself and let it be done unto you. Today's liturgy, today's gospel focuses our attention on the Blessed Eucharist, and it is a foretaste of the great feast of Corpus Christi, which we will soon have. But as St. Thomas said, that for which our Lord instituted the sacrament of his body and blood is unity of his mystical body. Unity of the mystical body. By this he means that our Lord instituted the sacrament of his body and blood so that we may partake sacramentally in his body and blood, and might undertake him and bring that unity to fulfillment, that we may be united to the head, and that we may be a member of the body, united one to another. The most blessed sacrament is the sacrament of unity, or the sacrament of union, for by it we are united to Christ, and Christ is united to us, and we are united to one another. That's why we must pray not only for and move in our own conversion, but the conversion of the whole world. We must offer our sacrifices, our penances, for that which is lacking in the body of Christ. For those bishops and for those people who do horrendous things, who apostatize and bring heresy and schism, we must pray for their conversion. We must not be stopped by any kind of human calculation, human politics, or disorder. For we must go to our blessed Lord, trust in him, turn to him, and receive the abundance of grace which flows from the most blessed sacrament. So today, let us rejoice, as that is the opening words of our Mass today. Laetare, let us rejoice. Laetare et conventum facite. Let us rejoice and come together, and let our hearts sing the words of our post-communion. Grant, we beseech you, merciful God, that we may treat with sincere reverence and consume with heartfelt faith your sacrament, which ever fills us to overflowing. May we trust in him. And when his grace fills us, may we do all that is necessary to bring about the kingdom of God, not just providing the bare minimum, but to overflowing. May this day, may it be so. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Credo in unum Deo,
Spiritum Sanctum Dominum, vivificante, qui ex Pater filioque procedit, qui cum Pater et Filium simul adorator et glorificatum, qui locutus est per prophetas, et una sancta catholicam, et apostolicam ecclesiam, confiteor unum baptismal, et remissionem peccatorum, et expecto resurrectionem mortuorum, et vita aeterna sequi.
Dominus vobiscum. Oremus.
Amen.
per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum. Sosum corda. Gratias agamus, Domino Deo nostro. Veri dignum eiusum essa quum salutare, nos tibi sempre dubique gratias agere. Domine Sancta Pater omnipotens etene Deus, qui corporale unio in vitia comprimis, mentite livas, virtutem lagiris e premia, per Christum Dominum nostrum, per quam majestatem tuam laudant angeli, odorandam nationes, tremont potestas, celi ceralunque virtutes ac beata serafim, socia exaltatione concelebrant, cum quibus et nostros vocis ut emiti iubias de precamor, supplice confessione dicente.
nobis quoque peccatoribus.
Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Oremus, receptis salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, viat volutas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitti nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Ex Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Domine non sum dignus. Domine non sum dignus. Domine non sum dignus.
et jergnus Dei, et ricatoris peccatum mundi. Domine non sunt dignus sed inscriptus tectum meum, sed tanem bic verbos in arbitrora diva mea. Domine non sunt dignus sed inscriptus tectum meum, sed tanem bic verbos in arbitrora diva mea. Domine non sunt dignus sed inscriptus tectum meum, sed tanem bic verbos in arbitrora diva mea.
Thank you. Dominus vobiscum.
Et tu spiritus tuo.
Oremus, da quesimus, da nobis quesimus misericordieus, ut sancta tua quibus inter sancter exemplor, sinceris fratemus obsequis et fidelis semper mentes humamus, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivis et regnas in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Quesumus omnipotens Deus acumulus tuus carolus, rex nostra quae tua miseratione, suscepit regni gabernacula, virtutem et inam omnium precipiat in clementum, quibus decenteron natus et vitiorum monstra diviare, et ad te quia viam veritas et vita est cum parole regina gratiosus variat, per venire, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Shrine Novena to Our Lady for the Priory Court and St. Mary's Academy. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our
death. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee.
Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who didst will that thy word should take flesh at the message of an angel, in the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary, grant to thy supplicant people that we who believe her to be truly the Mother of God may be helped by her intercession with thee, through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
As announced, any mother or grandmother in the congregation is welcome to come to the rail, receive a flower to honor their motherhood on this day of a Litari Sunday. It's not the liturgical action, so there are no kisses of the hand, no kisses of the flower. Thank you.